appreciate you listening in today and watching my Facebook. Thank you so much for your attention today. I count it an honor to be able to come again and bring, of course, all of our church folks by Facebook and many others who are watching as well. I want to say that I do appreciate you listening in. Do have several requests for prayer. I want to remember Bill Vandenhoy in prayer. He is an assisted living place in Winston-Salem, if you will remember Bill in prayer. And also, let's remember to pray for the Deborah Smith family. Her funeral service will be today at 3 o'clock. Lord willing, I'll be helping with that. And let me mention once again concerning our service times here at the church. We still don't know exactly when we're going to be able to be back to worship. And I know that a lot of states are lifting their quarantines and lifting their number of people. A lot of businesses trying to get back started. And we certainly need to pray that that will be successful. When you think about our economy being totally shut down, I can see a great need to have our economy open back up and allow people that are able to go back to work. Now, church will be a little bit different matter, I guess. And I will say that I truly miss my church folks so bad. There are just a few scattered out today. And I appreciate them being here and you as well. In just a few moments, the Hawkins family is going to sing for us, and we're looking forward to that. But thank each one of you for tuning in today, and we pray that the message will be a blessing. In just a little bit, I'm going to ask you to turn your Bible to the book of 1 Kings, chapter number 17. 1 Kings, chapter 17 will be our text today. And I will go to the Lord in a word of prayer today and ask His blessing and help to be on all of these requests. And I know there's many more. Now, I'm very thankful to say that I don't know anybody in our church family that has had the coronavirus. And we're very thankful for that. And we certainly want to pray for those who do have it. Let's remember those who serve in the medical field and those who basically are on the front lines of the coronavirus epidemic. And let's pray that the Lord will help us. And He is able. And let's pray that we'll help that to get on out of our country, life will turn to normal, because I'm sure looking forward to being able to do that in the house of God again to worship the Lord. And I've always thanked God for that opportunity. I've never taken that for granted. But Lord have mercy, I miss my church folks. I love them. They are my family, basically. And I miss each one of them. I was watching as many of you were clicking on just a few minutes ago. And gosh, I'd like to see, it's just terrible. And I miss our little kids here at the church as well. Seeing them lead up Sunday morning, go to Bible days, and just to have a good time of fellowship with them, we really miss it. So we're praying soon we'll be able to get back together. Let's start the Lord today in a word of prayer. Our Father, we are grateful for the privilege to meet together and just worship you this morning. We want to be an encouragement to all of our church folks, and I pray your blessings on every one of them. Lord, as I look at these empty pews, I know where everybody sits. I look up in the balcony, and I see empty seats, and Lord, I miss everybody, and I just pray your special blessing on them. Build a hedge about us as your church. May your hand be upon us. May we take this opportunity to draw closer to the Lord Jesus in these days. Our Father, I don't know the purpose and I don't know the reason that this epidemic has come upon not only the United States but the world. But I pray that we might look up and realize that God is in control. Our Father, we ask you now to bless everyone who listens and watches today. I pray for the Hawkins family as they sing. I pray that you'll touch them, bless them, anoint them. Thank you for them. Thank you for the folks who are here today to run the cameras and do the different things, Lord. We just pray your blessings on them as well. Now, our Father, for these who mentioned, sons in assisted living, I pray for them. We pray for these families that are bereaved. Touch them and comfort them according to your will. And our Father, we'll give you the glory and the honor because we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you pray for the Hawkins family as they come to sing, and they're going to sing one song, and then I'll preach a little short message, and then they'll be back to sing another song in just a little bit as well. I hope you'll enjoy it.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, Sherry Blankenship on piano. She's done all of these services for us, and we really do appreciate all of her help as well. And then, of course, several other folks that helped produce this, and we're very thankful for each one of them and for their willingness to come and to be a part of it. Now, with your Bible open, please, look at 1 Kings chapter number 17. I'll begin reading today with verse number 8. We'll just read about 8 verses and try to bring just a little thought that is on our heart today. Last week, we talked about Elijah at the brook, and today, I'll talk about Elijah at Zarephath. The Bible says in 1 Kings chapter 17, verse number 8, and the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, arise, get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. And he arose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow, a woman, was there gathering the sticks. And he called to her and said, fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. And as she was going to fetch it, he called to her and said, bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in thine hand. And she said, as the Lord thy God liveth, I have not a cake, but a handful of meal in a barrel, and a little crude oil in a cruse. And behold, I am gathering 2 sticks that I may go in and dress it for me and my son, that we may eat and die. And Elijah said unto her, fear not, go and do as thou hast said, but make me thereof a little cake first, and bring it unto me, and after make for thee and for thy son. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail, unto the day that the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah, and he said, and she and he and her house did eat many days. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by Elijah. Here in these verses, we find Elijah going down to a city that is called Zarephath. Now, last week when we talked about Elijah, he went down to the brook Cherith, and God said that he would provide for him there. He, of course, at that time would have the brook to drink off. And God said, I've commanded the ravens to feed thee there. And morning and evening, as faithful as they could be, the ravens came, and he did drink of that brook that was there. And when we think about Elijah and how God provided for him there, it was a test of his faith. And so it is when he goes down to Zarephath as well, that there is a test of his faith. Now, when I read these verses, beginning in verse 8, the Bible said that the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, arise and get thee to Zarephath. Now, the word Zarephath has a very unusual meaning. It means a workshop for refining metal. And in other words, metal is refined by putting it in the fire and purifying it. As far as I can tell, iron goes to a furnace, but it's not to refine it. The only things that you refine in a furnace are precious metals like gold and silver. And so Elijah's faith, being much more precious than gold and silver, is about to be tried in this place that is called Zarephath. And God says, I want you to get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zidon, and dwell there. And I like the word there. It recurs time and time again. He said, get to the brook Cherith, first of all, for I have commanded the ravens to feed thee there. So the there speaks of being in the will of God. If you are there, if you are in the will of God, God is going to provide for you. Now, here's a principle that I learned years ago. We have a responsibility to keep ourselves in the will of God. And once you are in the will of God, you are God's responsibility. In other words, God has obligated himself to see that your every need is met, and God will do that. God will never leave you anywhere. God will not provide for you. A country preacher said this. He said, where God leads, God feeds. And I do believe that with all of my heart. And as I thought about him going down, he does so according to the word of the Lord. And he said, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. Now, I see a progression in Elijah's faith. Most of the time, we think about those great Old Testament saints and the great people that they were and the great things that they did. We think that they're somehow above us. But God worked in Elijah's faith to increase it as he goes along. Elijah was sort of born as a mature believer in the Lord. He had to grow, just exactly like you and I do. And you know, sometimes, hard times, this dearth, this famine that came in the land, it was to help the people of God if they were allowed that opportunity. And so Elijah's faith is growing here. God speaks to him after he has had the experience of being fed by the ravens and drinking of the brook. Then, of course, here is this next experience that he has. And it's this widow woman. Now, I see a progression in his faith. Now, how is that? Well, think about this. When Elijah went to the brook Cherith, that was a natural thing to do. I mean, if there's no rain, what you going to do? You go to the creek. You go to where there is water. And that water, just like it always, it came out of the ground, and it was to sustain him. And that was a natural thing to do. The supernatural was that God commanded the ravens to bring him, if you will, the bread and the flesh. And that takes some faith to believe that a raven is going to bring food to you day and night. But yet God is the God of nature. He is in charge and he is in control of exactly that. But now he said, I want you to go down to Zarephath. There's a widow down there that's going to sustain you. Now you might say, well, it takes less faith to believe somebody's going to help you than does for the ravens to bring you. But quite the opposite is true. Think about in those days, if a woman was a widow, or a widow lady, her husband was dead, then she was doomed to a life of poverty. It was almost like a death sentence if something happened to the man in the family. And so here's a woman that is destitute. A couple of things I can say about her. First of all, she was a Gentile. Unlikely that she'd be willing to help a Jewish prophet. Secondly, she was a widow. Her circumstances and situation would be more difficult, took more faith to believe that she could sustain than with the brook and the ravens. But yet, that's what God says. And so without question, without hesitation, he arose and went to Zarephath. Now, I thought about it. The ravens were coming every morning and every evening. The brook dried up. Somebody said that a message ought to be preached on when the brook dries up and the birds stop flying. Pretty good thing for a message, I guess. But God spoke to him and said, go to Zarephath. And I believe that very day, the ravens did not come. That day, the brook dried up. There was no more water to be had. Because timing in God's economy is very important. We'll see why. Now, notice this. He went to Zarephath, verse number 10. And when he came to the gate of the city, the gate of the city was a gathering place. That's where the town council met. That was a busy place. Everybody that went in and went out of the city of Zarephath had to come through this gate. So there was probably a lot of people milling around. Now, when God said to go down to Zarephath, I commanded the widow to look at you. He did say, okay, Lord, I don't know how tall is she, what does she look like, what's her bank account like, none of that. He said he didn't describe her without description, without anything. He said, there's a widow there. I want you to go, and she's going to take care of it. And so when he said, there's a lot of people milling around the gate of the city. And notice what the Bible says. It says in verse number 10 she was there gathering sticks. And he called to her. And maybe she was by herself there. Maybe she sort of stood out. Maybe he thought, well, that's probably her. Without any way of knowing, he called to her and said, fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel. That's sort of a strange thing to ask. If you've been in our day, you know what that woman would have said? Get yourself. That's exactly right. But she didn't do that. The Lord said, The word had already come to her. Not only this woman was a believer in God. Even though she was a Gentile, she believed in the Lord. God worked on her then, and then worked on Elijah, said, you go down. And that woman will sustain thee there. So he said to her, fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. And notice in verse 11, as she was going to fetch it, he called to her and said, bring out a little morsel of bread in thy hand. He said, as long as you're going to get the water, I said, can I ask you another favor? Bring me a little piece of bread, a piece of cake, if you will. And I like that. And of course, she's being obedient. The Lord's worked in her heart. And by the way, ladies, that always helps, don't it? The Lord worked in my wife's heart. So when I ask her to give her a piece of cake, she don't fuss at me. She just does it. Amen. I know you fellas all thinking that. But either way, boy, if you can just see this crowd that's here, not many of them here, but there's a few husbands and wives here, and they're learning a lot today. They're already glad they came. But here it is, he said, bring me a morsel of bread, I pray thee, in thy hand. And she answered, and this is her answer. She said, as the Lord thy God liveth. She couldn't say, as the Lord my God, because remember, the Gentiles had no covenant with God. But here's a Jewish prophet. She said, as the Lord your God liveth. She said, I'm telling you the truth. I have not a cake, in other words, I have not made any bread, but all that I have is a handful of meal in a barrel and a little oil in a cruse. And she said, for the Lord said, I'm going out and I'm gathering just two sticks. That's all that's going to be required to make this little meal for me and my son. And we're going to eat, and then our resources are gone, and we're going to die as well. This man was in the land. There was no view. There was no name. I find in this Lord working in all life. Thought about it. You know, when the brook dried up and the birds stopped flying and Elijah did go down to Zarephath, she's already in the process of making the last meal that her and her son will have. She knows that when this is done, it's all over with, and make other people have died. And she too is going to die in this awful time of famine. Supposing Elijah had been 2 hours later, the meal had been eaten, and that last meal had been prepared. You see, not only was her fate, or Elijah's fate, depending on the right time, but her fate and her family's fate depended upon the obedience of Elijah being there in the will of God. And another thing that I saw in this, I like when he asked for water. He said in verse number 10, I pray thee, fetch me, I pray thee. Notice he says these two words, a little water. Can you imagine how scarce water was? Can you imagine how precious the commodity of just plain water was? We don't think about it too much in our part of the world. But I'll tell you something, water is a valuable commodity. And especially during a time of drought and famine. So he's asking something big of this woman. Her faith is being put to the test. A little bit later, when he says in verse number 13, he says this, make me a little cake thereof first. A little cake. You know, what I've always found out is that people that are depending on the Lord don't have to have a lot. God specializes in using the little things in our life. It was a lad who had 5 loaves and 2 little fishes, and yet placed in the hand of the Lord Jesus, they fed a multitude. So it is here, Elijah is asking for a little water and a little cake. Boy, how do I like some of the prosperity preachers of our day. I mean, they live in luxury, but that does not mark the people of God. He said just a little will be enough, a little water and one cake. Boy, it's a happy day in our life when we get in the will of God, realize that when God blesses us with little or with much, we're to be thankful for all of it. And here is just a little that he asked for. And he said, bring me, I pray, a morsel of bread. And she said, I don't have it. All we have to do, all we have left is just a handful of meal in a barrel and a little oil in a cruse. Now, place yourself in this little woman's shoes for just a little bit. No doubt she had been rationing that meal that was in that barrel. She didn't use a drop of oil that she didn't have to use. And so she managed now through good management to stretch it out, to make it last as long as possible. And now here it is, the last meal, and this is it. They're going to die, it's all. They're going to eat it up, they're going to die. Everything will be gone. And Elijah said to her in verse number 13, fear not, go and do as thou hast said. In other words, carry on with your plan to make this little cake. But he says, make me thereof first a little cake, and bring it unto thee, and after make for thee and for thy son. First thing that he said to her is to fear not. And you know what God had? Even though he has unlimited resources, a lot of times we feel that fear as well. And he's speaking from experience. He's already been in some scary situations. But he went down and dared to stand in King Ahab's faith and say to him, listen, it's not going to rain. There's not going to be any dew but by my word. Now that took a lot of faith to believe that. You think he was afraid to do that? He could have been beheaded on the spot for saying that to the king. When he went down to Cherith, he could have been afraid of running out there. He could have been afraid that the birds were not going to bring his meal. But you know what? He had exercised faith then. He had that experience behind him. And he could look at her and say, do not be afraid. God is going to provide. I don't know this to be the fact, but it has been said, and I've heard this several times, that fear not is found 365 times in our Bible. 365 times the phrase fear not appears in our Bible. You say, what is it? Well, that's one for every day of the year. Boy, that's like our experience. If we go through one thing and we think, boy, that's over with, and next day something else happened that tries our faith, that would tend to put a spirit of fear in us. And so we have to be careful about that we don't fear. So he said to her, fear not, go and do as thou hast said, but make me a little cake thereof first. Now I'll emphasize a little cake. Now Elijah was not a greedy man. He was God's man. He didn't have to have the best. Now think about that. He had been eating bread and flesh in the morning and in the evening, but here he's reduced down to just eating bread. Not find out if crises come to the world, they not only come to the world, but it affects us as well. Now, this coronavirus is going around. That's something that's happened all over the world. But you know what? We as a people of God, we are not exempt from the effects of this virus as well. So it affects all of us. And he said, make me thereof a little cake first. Boy, there ain't nothing like being happy and content with what you have. I was visiting in the neighborhood when I first moved to North Carolina. I was visiting in the neighborhood, and it was down in the Brooks' Crossroads area. And I went to this farmhouse, and I knocked on the door. And there was an older couple there, and I told them who I was, and I was a new preacher. And I had just moved into the community. And they said, well, come on in, preacher. Said, it's good to have you. He said, it's good to meet you. And I went in and I talked to that old couple. And we talked about their faith and how that they had gotten married. They'd been married about 60 or 70 years at the time. And they talked about when they first got married, it was during the Great Depression. And said they didn't have any money. And said that they had to, everything that they had to have, their coffee, their flour, and everything, they had to buy it on time. And then they put their tobacco crop out, and then when they get their tobacco in, they'd go and settle up at the local store, the man during those hard days of their early marriage. And that was a way of life in the country years ago. And they told me about that experience. And then I talked to a man who owned a country store years ago. He was an older gentleman. And this is what he said. He said, a lot of people come and would ask me for credit. They buy their groceries on the credit. And he said, when I would really give them credit, he said, I would always tell who was going to pay me and who wouldn't. And I said, well, how did you know that? He said, the people that had no intentions of paying me back would go through the store. He said, they'd just get an armload of everything. He said, you knew right off that they were getting more than they could afford. They didn't intend to ever pay me back. But said, the honest people that was going to pay, when they would go through the store, they just picked up the necessities. And they just picked up the very thing that they had to have. He said, that was an honest person when the prophet was home. He could always depend on them that they would come back and pay. So Elijah here said, give me a little water and a little cake, and that will be sufficient. And then notice also in verse number 14, for thus saith the Lord God of Israel. And here again, he's encouraging not only his own faith, but the faith of this woman that was going to take care of him. For thus saith the Lord of Israel, the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste. In other words, it will not run out, neither shall the cruse of oil fail. It will be sufficient until the day that the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. Boy, no doubt that helped this widow lady. Put yourself in her shoes. Why? Is she going to give that man of God the, I mean, what could have gone for her and her son? There was going to be no more after that. So the word of the Lord came, reassuring her that God was going to provide. And I'm glad to report to you today that the Lord's always provided for me, and he's always provided for his people. He's responsible to look after you as one of his children. And God is able to make that which may be little in our sight to go a long way with his blessing. And the Bible says in verse 15, she went and did according to the saying of Elijah. Not just to Elijah, but to his saying, where he quoted God as saying, I will provide. And so she believed the Lord. And she and he and her house did eat many days. Now, look at that little phrase. Said he, that is the prophet, and her house. Now, we know that she had a young child at this time. So, probably including her in that. But you know, it doesn't limit it just to her and her son. What if her extended family maybe came into their house and eat? If that was the case, it was all of her relatives. In other words, many of them, like Rahab's house. Well, she would have had all her kinfolks, and you come stay at my house. And when the children of Israel marched around the walls for 7 days, the walls did not fall where Rahab lived. The spies said, you get everybody that you won't spare, and you get them into your house. And I have no doubt that she had maybe aunts and uncles, maybe her grandmother, she was still living, and other folks who were around there, and her house, her relatives, did eat many days. And it's hard enough to feed one or two. If you have a growing boy like I do, I will tell you something, it's hard to feed one. Teenagers. But think about feeding the whole crowd in a time when there's dirt and there's nothing. While somebody broke in her house and went through her stuff. That's why this old woman ain't got a thing. Maybe not looking in that barrel down in the corner. Whoa, way down in the corner. There was a little handful of meal. Why, if I might even been enough, somebody said, well, I'm going to steal that even in a time of famine. But I'm going to tell you, and notice they did eat many days. And faithful to God's word, verse 16, the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by Elijah. My pastor used to have a sermon that he preached on this particular passage of scripture, and he entitled it Glory in the Kitchen. And can you imagine she scraped the bottom of the barrel every time? Last handful of meal, but she prepared that, and they all ate till they were full. Maybe they thought the barrel was empty, and maybe it was until the next time. But I could see that little woman going in there, taking the cob off that barrel. I guess it was a big barrel, but I could see her reaching down to the sides of it. And over here on this side, there's nothing. And on this side, there's nothing. But over here in this last corner, there's a handful of meal. That's God. May I encourage all of us today to look to him who has unlimited resources. He is the Lord of glory. The same God that Elijah had is our God. One final thing, I'm going to say this. The first recorded sermon of Jesus that Luke in his gospel tells us of, Jesus went to the synagogue. And he read out of the scripture. And he told them that day that scripture was fulfilled in their hearing. He was preaching in Nazareth. And that was where Jesus grew up. And he said to them, they were Jews, Jesus was a Jew, preaching to the Jewish audience. He said, a prophet hath no honor in his own country. They looked at Jesus and they said, you know what? This is Mary and Joseph's son, the carpenter's son. Said his brothers and sisters, they're here. They didn't pay him any attention. They didn't give him honor that was due him. And Jesus quoted how Elijah went to the widow's house and how God provided. He said, you know what? God sent Elijah down to Zarephath, to a widow's house. Why? Because they didn't want Elijah in Israel. But a Gentile about it. He also talked about Naaman, who was a leper. He was a Gentile. And yet he came up and got help there. They were both Gentiles. And when Jesus just quoted what I read today, it made that crowd that he preached to so angry that they took it outside the cities and threw it down the hill. Because the Jews rejected the preaching of Elijah. The nation of Israel did not repent during the famine. They didn't repent as preaching. They turned a deaf ear to it. And I'm afraid there's a lot of people during this time of crisis that are turning a deaf ear to the word of God, the people of God. But I'm saying this, you better not, you better get ready. Because I believe the Lord Jesus is soon to come. Our Father, we thank you for your goodness to us. I pray that you'll bless the word as it goes forward. Thank you for the song we've already heard. Thank you for the song that we're about to hear. And we give you glory in Jesus' name. Bless everyone because we ask it for your glory. Amen. Thank you for listening. You pray for the Hawkman family.